The urea cycle is a very important pathway by which ammonia is detoxified and converted into more soluble, less toxic urea and excreted in urine. This is mainly happening because we are ureotelic the humans or the organism which excrete urea in the urine are known as ureotelic. Urea cycle is a very important pathway taking place inside the liver, and this is was first discovered by the scientists Krebs and Hanselit, and that's why it is also known as Krebs-Hanselit cycle. It is taking place inside the mitochondria and also in the cytosol. So first one and two steps is taking place inside the mitochondria because the enzymes are specifically present inside the mitochondria. Rest, all other step is present or taking place inside the cytosol. So what happens is the compound or the product intermediate which is formed from the mitochondria has to be transported to the cytosol, and if any transporter deficiency or transporter defect is there, that can also lead to some form of the urea cycle defect. So this is the pathway which is showing how urea cycle or urea formation is taking place inside the mitochondria as well as in the cytoplasm. Now urea is a compound which is composed of which has a structural formula as NH2 C double bond NH2. So it has two nitrogen and one carbon and oxygen. So the first nitrogen is given by your ammonia, second nitrogen by your aspartate, and carbon and oxygen is given by your bicarbonate. So urea is formed in our body like this. So this this formation is taking place by the help of the different enzymes, and once urea is produced in the liver, it is transported to the kidney where it is completely reabsorbed and excreted in the urine. Now the reactions of the cycle, which is very very important. So the first two reactions is taking place inside the mitochondria, where two enzymes known as carbamyl phosphate synthase 1 and your ornithine transcarbamylase. These two enzymes, these are present in the mitochondria, forming your first step, that is from ammonia and carbon dioxide, it is going to give you carbamyl phosphate by the help of enzyme CPS1. We'll be looking onto the structure later, and this is this carbamyl phosphate is ultimately giving you ornithine, it is giving, that is ornithine transcarbamylase, it forms citrulline, and this citrulline is transported into the cytosol where the further reaction of your urea cycle is happening. Now this is the overview of the urea cycle. Here you can see that this is the first two steps which is taking place in the mitochondria, and then this is the one which is taking place inside the cytosol. Now the first step of the urea biosynthesis by carbamyl phosphate synthase 1, CPS1, is the enzyme which is also the rate limiting enzyme, because the urea cycle rate can be increased or decreased by inhibiting or activating this enzyme. So CO2, ammonia and ATP, it combines and it undergoes series of your chemical transformation. Here you can see bicarbonate plus ATP, it is forming an intermediate known as carbonic phosphoric acid anhydride, which undergoes undergoes structural changes forming carbamate and ultimately giving you carbamyl phosphate with the help of an ATP. So two ATPs are required, and this is an energy requiring process. In this way, carbon dioxide, ammonia and ATP, these all collaborate to form carbamyl phosphate by the help of carbamyl phosphate synthase 1. This is the rate limiting enzyme, and it is activated by an activator and acetylglutamate, and studies have shown that even the enzyme is efficient or it is functional, if there is deficiency of this N-acetylglutamate, that can also lead to urea cycle defect because CPS1 is not functional in those cases. So here N-acetylglutamate is formed from acetyl-CoA and glutamate by help of enzyme N-acetylglutamate synthase. So here it is the enzyme N-acetylglutamate synthase which forms this compound. Now you must have heard about CPS1 and CPS2 in some other metabolic pathway as well. We are today talking about CPS1, which is entirely present in mitochondria, that is for urea cycle. You have heard CPS2 in pyrimidine metabolism, which was present solely in cytosol. So CPS1, both of it is going to give you carbamyl phosphate only, but the mechanism of action and the metabolite which it is forming in the further reaction is different. CPS1 is present in the mitochondria and it is for urea cycle. It is activated allosterically by the compound known as N-acetylglutamate, and it is the source of nitrogen here is ammonia. And it is not inhibited by any of the compounds. While your CPS2 is the enzyme for pyrimidine metabolism, we do not have any activator, but is inhibited if it has more amount of your CTP, that is cytidine triphosphate, which is a pyrimidine present, and glutamine serves for the nitrogen for your the one which CO2 plus NH3, the first reaction which is catalyzed by carbamyl phosphate synthase 2, this nitrogen is given by glutamine here in case of pyrimidine metabolism. Here ammonia is the one which contributes for your carbamyl phosphate formation. Now this is the whole urea cycle and its steps. So the one which is here in the lighter pink one is your present in your mitochondria. Two enzymes is present in the mitochondria. One is the CPS1, the second one is ornithine transcarbamylase. Here the one which is formed is the first step is carbamyl phosphate. It is the rate limiting step. It means that after formation of CPS1, it is allosterically regulated by N-acetylglutamate, and after forming carbamyl phosphate in the mitochondria, it is going to give your going for the urea cycle only. So after carbamyl phosphate, it combines with your ornithine, it converts, it forms citrulline. So citrulline can be transported via simple diffusion. So once citrulline is present, it is formed still in the mitochondria, it is transported to your cytosol, and this citrulline it combines with aspartate to form arginosuccinate. This is an important intermediate in your urea cycle. By the help of arginosuccinate synthetase, which undergoes further degradation by forming fumarate, converting it into arginine. This arginine undergoes dehydration reaction forming urea, and ornithine is replenished, or it is reformed, or it is recycled. This ornithine has to be transported inside the mitochondria to form citrulline. So if this ornithine transport is not present or it is not transported, it can lead to deficiency as same as that of your ornithine transcarbamylase deficiency or urea cycle defect. So the whole cycle is taking place in the mitochondria as well as in the cytosol by the help of the transport of citrulline from mitochondria to cytosol and ornithine from the cytosol to the mitochondria. Two important components are formed here, that is aspartate. It is formed, can be formed from oxaloacetate, by which is from the TCA cycle, and fumarate, it goes for the TCA cycle to replenish it, or it can fill up the TCA cycle. So there are two cycles which are the similar of the nature, and the product can be used otherwise. So that's why the urea cycle and the TCA cycle is also known as urea bicycle. Now the stoichiometry or the summary of the reaction of urea synthesis is you are using energy there, because 3 ATP is utilized, the first in the activation or formation of carbamyl phosphate, and then in the second step also. So 3 ATP is utilized, and then carbon dioxide and ammonia, it is converted with the help of aspartate and 2 molecule of water. It gives urea, ADP, AMP and fumarate. So urea is energy requiring process or metabolic activity which is happening in your body for detoxifying your nitrogen skeleton of the amino acid. urea cycle is linked to gluconeogenesis. That is the stoichiometry of urea cycle. If you see, there is utilization of the energy, that is pyrophosphate, if it is rapidly hydrolyzed, which can give which requires again energy. So ultimately 4 energy is required, that is 4 ATP is required for the whole urea cycle to happen. And synthesis of the fumarate, which is happening in the urea cycle by degradation of arginosuccinate, is important because it is utilized for glucose synthesis. Fumarate is converted into malate, which is ultimately giving oxaloacetate. This oxaloacetate goes for gluconeogenesis. So urea cycle is also linked for the synthesis of glucose. Here you can see the fumarate, which is formed, it can go for formation of oxaloacetate, and it goes for glucose. Oxaloacetate is also replenishes aspartate for the urea cycle to happen smoothly. So these two cycles are integrated. Now I have talked about urea bicycle. This is an example where it is showing that one of the urea cycle is happening here, and here TCA cycle is happening at the side also. So this part of TCA cycle is replenishing aspartic acid by the help of oxaloacetate. So oxaloacetate is converted into aspartic acid by the help of aspartate transaminase, and replenishing aspartate to form arginosuccinate in urea cycle. So to summarize urea cycle, we have ammonia, which is need to be detoxified, and then carbon dioxide, that is mainly from the bicarbonate, and water. All of these goes for the carbamyl phosphate synthesis, and this carbamyl phosphate is ultimately converted into citrulline in mitochondria itself. This citrulline can be transported into the cytosol, which goes further reaction where arginosuccinate is formed by the help of arginosuccinate synthetase. Arginosuccinate, when it gets degraded into arginine, it liberates fumarate. This fumarate can go for gluconeogenesis by this same pathway where it forms oxaloacetate. This arginine, which is formed, goes a dehydration reaction, it forms urea and also recycles ornithine. So this ornithine recycles and this urea cycle goes on and on. And here the replenishment of your aspartic acid to the urea cycle and fumarate to your TCA cycle is happening side by side. That's why it is also known as urea bicycle. Now coming on to metabolic disorders of urea synthesis. Why it is important? Metabolic disorders of urea synthesis is mainly concerned because we are very much concerned for ammonia toxicity. High ammonia is leading to number of CNS related symptoms like your encephalopathy. It can also lead to increase in the pH, respiratory alkalosis, hyperammonemia, ATP depletion, decreased energy to the body, your glutamine, which is osmotically active, it causes more and more degradation to your brain cells, also leading to the accumulation of your excitatory toxins in the brain, and this can lead to number of other consequences. So urea cycle defect is not only concentrated on the high ammonia, it is also because the metabolite which is formed, that is citrulline, ornithine, that can also accumulate and which can cause the number of pathological condition. So mainly the urea cycle defect is characterized by vomiting, avoidance of high protein foods, and lethargy, severe mental retardation, and intermittent ataxia. So metabolic disorders are associated with each of the pathway. Here you can see that the first part, that is the rate limiting step, is carbamyl phosphate synthase 1. If it is deficient, the condition known as hyperammonemia type 1 happens, because still here we have carbon dioxide, ammonia, and ATP, which is formed by CPS1. If this CPS1 is deficient, this ammonia cannot be converted into carbamyl phosphate. So we have increase in the ammonia in the blood. The condition is known as hyperammonemia type 1. Then ornithine transcarbamylase. So ornithine transcarbamylase is converting carbamyl phosphate to citrulline by the help of the linking with ornithine. So if you don't have your ornithine transcarbamylase, there is more amount of your ammonia that is hyperammonemia, as well as there is more amount of ornithine which is less common, but it can be characterized by this also. The third pathway, the third mechanism or third disorder is the deficiency of arginosuccinate synthase. If this is deficient, we have increase in citrulline. That is, since ammonia is majorly converted into carbamyl phosphate and then to your citrulline. So if there is arginosuccinate synthase deficiency, arginosuccinate cannot be formed further. So citrulline gets accumulated in blood, and there is also citrullinuria, that is, it can be excreted in urine. So this can happen in case of citrullinemia. The fourth one is arginosuccinate lyase, where arginosuccinate is lyase to form arginine, and in this case fumarate is liberated. If it is absent, your arginosuccinate is more in the blood. There can be more citrulline as well in the blood, and in this case more amount of the arginosuccinate accumulation can lead to friable and tufted hair. So the fifth one is the deficiency of enzyme arginase. This arginate is breaking down arginine into urea and forming again reformation of ornithine. If this is not there, arginine will be more in the body, and it is also known as hyperarginemia. Also, that increase in arginosuccinate may be present in the blood. Again, another very important enzyme deficiency is N-acetylglutamate synthase. I told you this is the allosteric activator of your CPS1. So if your N-acetylglutamate synthase is not present, it can lead to defect in carbamyl phosphate synthase 1, and it can lead to symptoms of increase in ammonia, hyperammonemia type 1. Then there is another syndrome which is associated with urea cycle defect, that is not because of the enzyme defect but because of the defect of ornithine transporter. We all know that ornithine, it is present in the cytosol. It has to be moved or transported to mitochondria via ornithine transporter to form citrulline. So if this transporter is defective, this ornithine is not transported, and it leads to triple H syndrome, that is hyperornithinemia, hyperammonemia, and homocitrullinuria. This is mainly because of the lysine is carbamylated to citrulline, which can cause homocitrullinemia, and this is known as because of the deficiency of ornithine transporter, and it is known as triple H syndrome.